As we continue to explore quantum body, the new science of living a longer, healthier, more vital life, let's explore the mind-body problem, the mind-body or mind-brain problem, as it is currently referred to. So lift your hand up. Lift it. Now, how did you do that? You started with an intention, which is in the mind, and then your body moved. The sequence of events is you had an intention, then a part of your brain called the motor cortex got activated, and that sent electrical impulses to the arm and the muscles, and they contracted and you lifted your arm. So that's, we know, is the sequential unfoldment of any motor activity. You decide to speak, motor cortex, speech cortex gets activated, or some areas of the brain get activated. Electrical impulses are sent to the vocal cords. They start vibrating and you start to speak. So why is this a problem? Well, that first step, how does the intention activate motor activity? That's called the heart problem. It's part of the heart problem. How does the thought influence a material object like the brain, which then creates electrical impulses? Everything here happens is matter. So it starts with the mind and it is followed by a material expression. So if these two are different, mind and body are different, then you can't explain this. You know, if mind and body are different, then what is the mediator between mind and body? The first step, how does the thought activate the motor cortex? That's part of the heart problem. The first step in any motor activity, any movement, muscle movement, vocal cords movement, and from the autonomic nervous system, the movement of our visceral organs, etc., cannot explain this if you think that mind and body are two different substances, or mind and brain are two different substances. Now let's take the opposite experience, not motor activity, but sensory activity. So I'm speaking and you're hearing. The first step in that is vibration of your eardrums, you know, and the atmosphere vibrating, eardrums vibrating, cilia and the hair vibrating, electrical impulses go to the brain, sensory cortex gets activated, you hear sound. That last step is unexplainable. All the initial steps are explainable in sensory experience. Similarly, when you see me, photons go to your eyes and, you know, they cross over optic nerves, they hit the retina, electrical impulses all the way to the brain, electrochemistry, and you see me, you see the world. That last step, not explainable. If matter and mind are different things, you can't explain it. So what is it that converts the material energy into the experience that we call hearing? Because that's a hearing is an experience. It's a qualia, quality of experience. Or seeing is a qualia, mental experience. Seeing is mental, hearing is mental. How does this material activity? And of course, then where is the sound? Because there's no sound in the brain. And where is the image? There's no image in the brain. These are problems that have been asked since the time of Plato. They've been addressed by scientists, neuroscientists, because everybody in the world has tried to address them, and they remain unanswered. If mind and matter are two different things, how they interact? So they have to be one thing. Okay, so let's say it's all matter. Okay, then how does matter produce mind? Okay, it's all one thing. That doesn't explain anything. Matter can only be transformed into matter? How does matter, brain matter, for that matter, become thoughts and feelings and emotions and desires and imagination and, sound and touch and sight and taste and smell? That experience can't be explained either. The first step in motor activity cannot be explained. The last step in sensory activity cannot be explained. And that's all we have, motor and sensory activity. And also we have thoughts, feelings, emotions, imagination. None of this can be explained with the matter only concept. So what's left? Mind only? Doesn't explain how mind interacts with matter. So let me give you a third possibility, which is the only possibility, okay? And that is consciousness only, awareness only. And that is a field of possibilities, period. It's a field of uncertainty. It's a field of where we orchestrate attention, intention. It's a field of creativity, but it's a formless field with no borders. It's infinite and it's irreducible. It has no form and it cannot be seen, touched, sight, tasted, smelled, imagined, whatever. If it can be thought of, it can be conceptualized, if it can be imagined, if it can be touched, tasted, smelled, thought of, imagined, comprehended in any way, then it's not awareness. It's not the real thing. The only real thing is this, which is formless. And it can't be imagined because it has no borders and it has it's infinite, it's spaceless, it's timeless, but it makes every experience possible. So that awareness modifies itself into every conceivable knower, which is mind-like, mode of knowing, which is the activity of mind, and then that which is known, which is also the perceptual activity, which is linked to mental activity. So awareness is modifying itself as mind, as intellect, as ego, as the perceptual activity of the world, which we call the world, but it's actually a perceptual activity, which is a modification of consciousness only. And so too, the motor activity, the movement, is a modification of awareness as that activity. So awareness constantly modifies itself as sensations, sense perceptions, images, feelings, thoughts, every possible experience that you can have. And then we human beings give names to those experiences. So when we're having thoughts and feelings, we give it the name mind. When we collect a bunch of experiences and identify ourselves with that, we call that the ego. When we look at an alchemy of sensations and perceptions, we call that the physical world and the physical body. But you see, those are human labels for just consciousness modifying itself into experience. That's it. And we are that. And we are infinite, borderless, timeless, having a vacation in the theater of space-time and causality, which is our own projection. So take away all your labels and what's left, you as the divine self. And there's therefore no mind-brain problem. There's no mind-body problem. There's no problem how you interact with the world. It's all one thing. And that one thing is not a thing. It's a field of possibilities, formless, unbounded, eternal, timeless, shapeless, and the divine you. Take away all your labels, because every label confines you. And what's left is the infinite you. That's all you have to do. Ask yourself, who am I? Am I the changing body? Obviously not, but I am the awareness in which the body is changing as an experience. Am I changing mind? Obviously not. Mind changes all the time, but the awareness doesn't change. Just like the screen on your computer where the images and sounds and textures, characters are changing, but the screen is eternally one, differentiating into innumerable knowers, innumerable modes of knowing, innumerable things known. The quantum body is the window to that reality. Because quantum mind, quantum body, quantum universe are all one formless being experiencing itself as infinite knowers, infinite modes of knowing, infinite things known. Now, I know sometimes this is redundant and it seems like, oh, I've heard it before, but sometimes it leads to a new insight. In any case, I enjoy sharing it with you, so thank you for listening.